Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Imitation, The Basics by Naomi Van Bergen, Allard R. Fedes, Liesbeth Mann, and Bertjan Doosje. Narrated by Lianne Walker. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. 1. The Roots and Roots of Imitation. Introduction. Ah! A soft cry from a newborn baby in the middle of the night, in a quiet and dark hospital room filled with 20 newborn babies. After a short silence, a second newborn baby starts to cry as well. Wah! Wah! Within seconds, a third baby joins in. Within 1 minute, after the first soft cry, all the newborn babies in the room are crying loud and clearly. What has happened here? Is this imitation or what? Imitation is a powerful human tendency. We imitate each other a lot, sometimes on purpose, such as when we imitate ideas of influences or the way famous pop stars dress. And sometimes we're not so much aware of our tendency to imitate. For example, when we talk together, we tend to imitate each other's bodily posture without much awareness. Did the newborn babies in the hospital imitate intentionally? Or did they merely respond to one of the most upsetting sounds to humans? A crying baby. In this book, we answer fascinating questions about imitation. Why do we imitate? Which behaviours do we imitate? When do we imitate? In which situations? Who do we imitate? Who is more likely to imitate? How is imitation related to the brain? Is there a dark side to imitation? Do other animals also imitate? And are there cultural differences in imitation? Why is imitation important? Imitation is important to humans. We learn by imitation. We have teachers, coaches, trainers, parents, caregivers, etc. They are all likely to teach us how to do certain things by demonstrating to us how to do it. As such, imitation is a powerful learning tool. The teacher, coach, trainer, or parent performs certain behaviour, and we aim to copy it as good as we can. This example behaviour can range from relatively simple instructions. Parent: a cat says, meow. Can you say, meow? Child: meow. To a relatively complex set of instructions. For example, directors may first play a scene themselves in order to show actors how they should act in that scene. We assume the importance of imitation when we say that we have to set a good example, as a parent, as a boss, etc. We know that people often follow examples. How do we know this? Well, this is apparent from watching trends, fashions, or styles. For example, in the way we dress, make music, dance, make art, use language, cook, and eat, we follow trends, fashions, and styles. Typically, these trends are in fashion for a certain time and then disappear, or we transform them. For example, the way we dress now is different from 10 years ago as fashion has changed. Similarly, the things we eat today are different from 10 years ago. In some parts of the world, we now eat less meat than 10 years ago, for example. This list of trends in human behaviour is endless. These trends tell us two things. First, they indicate that we really do imitate, but second, oftentimes only for a limited period of time. Thus, trends show us that there is a limit to our imitation. At one point, some of us no longer follow the general trend and want to take a different route. People start thinking out of the box, and that is when new discoveries are made. And oftentimes we start new trends and start all over again with imitation. The roots of imitation. We humans have always lived in groups. First in hunter-gathering groups, later in agricultural groups, later again in industrialized cities, and nowadays we even live together digitally online. In all of these groups, people have imitated each other. This was an important way to learn about the sometimes dangerous world. How to make tools to hunt, where to find fruit, and how to make fire to prepare food and scare predators. These were significant behaviours that have shaped the history of our world. These behaviours were transmitted via imitation. Children learned them via imitating their parents or other older people. Thus, imitation serves an evolutionary function. Without imitation, humans would not have been as successful as we are today. Following an evolutionary argument, we may have become relatively prone to imitate because it has been such an effective way to adjust to changing environments. For example, when a new ice age started, humans were able to effectively deal with the challenges, that is, using hides to dress warm. Therefore, it is possible that the people who frequently imitated were more likely to pass on their genes to the next generation. Over thousands of years, this created an ever more likely inclination in humans to imitate each other. Interestingly, lots of other animals have survived due to imitation. This is most evident when we look at dangerous situations. When in danger, fear spreads quickly among animals. This is a useful strategy if you want to live a long life. The two roots of imitation. Closely linked to the roots of imitation, we suggest that there are two routes to imitation. The first route is the learning route. This route explains how we learn new behaviours by looking at others. We depict this route in Figure 1.3, which can be found in the print and ebook versions of this book. It involves 5 steps. In step 1, we are faced with an unfamiliar situation or problem. We wonder how we should solve this problem. In step 2, we search for role models. Do other people have a clue on how to deal with this situation or problem that I face? If we see a useful role model, we imitate. Step 3. In step 4, we can find out that it works. Finally, in step 5, we are proud of ourselves, which results in high personal well-being. This will lead to sustainable behaviour. We'll do it again like this next time around. The second route to imitation is the social route, and it is depicted in Figure 1.4. This route deals with social situations. When facing an unfamiliar social situation, we often wonder how we should behave. Step 1. What is appropriate in this situation? Again, when uncertain, people often search for role models. Step 2. What do others do? If we find a suitable role model, we start imitating the model. Step 3. Consequently, we may experience that other people start liking us, as people tend to like people who are similar to themselves. Step 4. This then may result in high social well-being. Step 5. Wow, I'm happy and I am glad to be part of this group. Subsequently, we will repeat this imitative behaviour next time when we are in such a situation. Both routes are similar in the sense that we search for role models when we feel uncertain. But they are different in that sometimes we actively search for specific role models to solve a difficult problem, the learning route, whereas in other times we aim to know how to behave socially in a situation by looking at how most others behave, the social route. They also have different endpoints. We can feel good about ourselves when we have solved a problem by imitating another person, the learning route, but we can feel good as a group member when we experience that other people like us after we have imitated them, the social route. When taking the social route, imitation can be seen as a social glue. You can actually take advantage of this fact. Box 1.2 explains how you can use imitation in order to become a millionaire. In figures 1.3 and 1.4, we have sketched an ideal outcome. We imitate another person and the problem is solved, which makes us feel good about ourselves. Figure 1.3. Or other group members start liking me better, which makes me feel good because I feel accepted. Figure 1.4. However, unfortunately, life is not always that easy. Sometimes it does not work that way. For example, sometimes imitating the wrong people might lead to negative outcomes for us, such as an incorrect answer to a problem, or others start to dislike us because we imitate them. Although, as we shall discuss, that latter outcome is less likely to occur. When that happens, we may change our strategy. We can go back to step 2 in both routes. We search for other potentially successful role models and start imitating them in hopes of a better outcome. It is possible to distinguish two types of imitation. One is the imitation of simple gestures, such as hand movements to move puzzle pieces, sometimes referred to as mimicry or the chameleon effect. The other type involves copying of goal-directed behaviour, such as putting the puzzle pieces together. It makes sense to consider these two different types of imitation because, for example, young children are able to mimic simple hand movements but cannot imitate more complex goal-directed behaviour. Similarly, when we get older, say above 70 years, we might be able to still mimic a simple hand movement. However, the capacity to imitate more complex movements with two hands will deteriorate by that age, unfortunately. We still might be able to stick out our tongue, though, like the 7-day-old monkey in figure 1.5. Figure 1.3, the learning route to imitation. 5 steps. Step 1, unfamiliar situation. How should I solve this problem? Step 2, search for role models. Do others have a clue? Step 3, imitation. I'll do what they do. Step 4, consequence. It works. Step 5, personal well-being. Hooray, I'm proud. Figure 1.4, the social route to imitation. 5 steps. Step 1, unfamiliar situation. How should I behave? Step 2, search for role models. What do others do? Step 3, imitation. I'll do what they do. Step 4, consequence. They like me. Step 5, social well-being. Wow, I'm happy. Box 1.2, how to become a millionaire. A good tip for waiters or waitresses. Yes, of course, robbing a bank is the quickest route to becoming a millionaire. But if you do not have what it takes to rob a bank, please consider this option. Become a waiter or waitress and follow this instruction carefully. Literally imitate the orders that you receive. Come again? How does that work? A fascinating study by psychologists has shown that when waiters exactly repeat an order using the customer's words, they receive a higher tip. For example, consider the following conversation. Customer, can I have a cappuccino and a carrot cake, please? Waiter, yes, of course. So you want a cappuccino and a carrot cake. In this case, the waiter repeats the order in the same words, but the conversation could easily have been as follows. Customer, can I have a cappuccino and a carrot cake, please? Waiter, yes, of course. I'll get it right away for you. In both cases, one could argue the waiter makes a favourable impression. But in situation 1, the waiter is bound to receive a higher tip than in situation 2. Why? Imitation. The scientists do not exactly know why imitation works for the waiter, but we do know that when people imitate us, we tend to like them, most likely because we like ourselves. As a side note, this makes it less likely for people with depressive symptoms to follow the cycle from being imitated to feeling liked. So, if we're embarking on a waiter or waitress career, we should make sure that we imitate the exact orders of our customers as closely as possible. This will result in lots of tips, and sure enough, one day, we'll be millionaires. Outline of this book. Why do humans imitate others? In Chapter 2, existing social, psychological, and developmental psychological theories on imitation will be described. This includes an evolutionary perspective asserting that imitation is an adaptive form of learning, the learning route, and a social psychology perspective claiming that imitation is associated with being liked by other group members, the social route. In Chapter 2, we also discuss developmental psychological perspectives, including theories of language acquisition and neurocognitive perspectives, describing mirror neurons. Where does imitation take place in the brain? How does imitation behavior develop throughout our lives? In this book, we describe five developmental stages in life: infancy, Chapter 3, childhood, Chapter 4, adolescence, Chapter 5, adulthood, Chapter 6, and late adulthood, Chapter 7. We describe characteristic forms of imitation occur in these life stages. In doing so, we provide answers to the following questions. A. Who do humans imitate? Here, we describe studies on models who are more likely to be copied than others. For example, we describe the phenomenon that people are more likely to imitate celebrities in art, sports, etc., in comparison with unknown people. This is called the prestige bias. B. Who is more likely to imitate others? Here we focus on who is more prone to imitate others. For example, adolescents are particularly prone to imitate their peers compared to people in other age groups. We will also focus on clinical disorders. For example, by focusing on disorders associated with reduced tendencies to imitation, such as autism. C. What kind of behaviors do humans imitate? Imitation can involve positive or negative behaviors. Take, for example, the ice bucket challenge, where people across the world copied each other to raise money for charity. Other behavior that often involves imitation is demonstrating and collective action. Think of the Black Lives Matter movement. However, we will also focus on the so-called dark side of imitation, as we'll describe next. D. Is there a dark side to imitation? Here we focus on imitational behaviors with negative consequences. For example, in Chapter 5 on imitation in adolescence, we will describe the phenomenon of copycat suicide and give other examples when the human tendency to imitate is used questionably. For example, the decision to join a criminal group or even a terrorist group. E. When do humans imitate each other? Here we focus on the role of the environment. Do particular situations lead to more or less imitation? As well as on group processes, the influence other people have on the likelihood to imitate or not. For example, when we feel uncertain, we are more likely to imitate behaviors of others in an attempt to reduce this uncertainty. In line with this idea, at the beginning of COVID-19, people started buying toilet paper en masse. We also discuss the role of two types of social norms. Descriptive norms refer to people considering what others do. Injunctive social norms refer to the phenomenon that people's behavior that is not normative for the social group results in corrections, that is, punishment by other group members. F. Are there cultural differences in imitation? Here we focus on intercultural studies of imitation and the value people attach to it, For instance, imitation is seen as a form of flattery in some cultures, whilst in other cultures it is more likely to be seen as a form of unoriginality. G. Do animals imitate? Here we focus on imitation in the animal kingdom, including herd behaviours. We also pay attention to imitation between different species, such as monkeys imitating each other. We draw analogies between human imitation and animal imitation. For example, is the contagion of fear in humans similar to the behaviour of herd animals when threatened? Finally, in Chapter 8, we summarise the main findings. In that chapter, we also draw conclusions about the significant role of imitation in the life of humans. We hope you will enjoy this journey of how imitation behaviour plays a role throughout our lives. Box 1.3. What you should definitely remember from this chapter. Humans imitate a lot. Imitation is the basis for social glue. Not only humans imitate, other animals do so too. Waiters around the world, thou shalt imitate and by doing so make a fortune. Chapter 2. Theories on imitation. Introduction. Humans of all times like to imitate each other. In the 1930s, people looked at Hollywood stars for style inspiration. In the 1960s, almost every household was the proud owner of a lava lamp. In the 1990s, the Rachel haircut was popular because women wanted to look just like Jennifer Aniston from the hit TV series Friends. And now, in the 2020s, supermarkets all over the globe experienced toilet paper shortages because people decided to buy the last roll just in case needed for a global pandemic. To express it lightly, humans are interesting beings. In this chapter, we answer important questions about imitation. What is imitation? Why do humans copy each other? Who is likely to be copied? And lastly, is imitation rooted in the brain? Together we will discuss the theories about imitation. What is imitation? Before we can dive into the whys and whos, it's important to first define what we mean by imitation. In Box 2.1, a definition of imitation is given, which was taken from the dictionary. For our purposes, Definition 1 and Definition 6 are most fitting. When we refer to imitation, we typically mean behaviour that is copied by one person after observing someone else doing this very behaviour. Hence, two cognitive skills are required. First, we need to be able and willing to observe others. Second, we need to be able and willing to replicate it. There are two types of imitation, voluntary and automatic imitation. Both will be covered in this book. Voluntary imitation is a conscious process. We decide to imitate someone else. For example, when we decide to buy a new brand of toothpaste simply because our favourite influencer brushes their teeth with it. Automatic imitation happens without the imitator being aware of it happening. For example, when we automatically yawn upon seeing somebody else yawn. Unconscious imitation is typically called mimicry. We will talk about mimicry more later in this chapter. Importantly, what do we not consider to be imitation? As you will learn in this book, this is a difficult question. For now, we can say that the following cases do not concern imitation: synchronization and complementary behaviours. Synchronization refers to different elements of a system working together as one coherent structure. For example, in Figure 2.2, which can be found in the print and ebook versions of this book, a group of birds is shown flying in a neat V-shape in a synchronized system. Each bird is an element and together they make up the system. Humans can also make up systems together. For example, when a group of people collectively synchronize their behavior by chanting a song in a soccer stadium, marching in a parade or dancing at a music festival. Although these people, the elements, are all doing the same thing, they are not necessarily imitating each other. They are synchronizing together, each human being one of the elements in the system. The birds flying in a V-shape, for example, are not necessarily imitating each other, else they might as well fly in conga line style. However, one could argue that in order to achieve synchronization, at least some elements of the system are imitating some of the behaviors from the other elements. Hence, the birds do need to start flying when they see the group taking off, or else they're left behind. Complementary behaviors are also similar, yet different to imitational behaviors. Here, two or more people complete each other's actions. Sometimes both individuals make the exact same movement, making it look like imitation. For example, if your friend wants to shake your hand, they will reach out with their right hand. Therefore, you do the exact same. You reach out your right hand. Hence, to someone unfamiliar with the concept of a handshake, it might look like you are copying your friend. However, you were not copying them. You were completing the action initiated by your friend, ending in shaking each other's hands. Box 2.1, Dictionary Definition of Imitation. According to the Merriam-Webster Dictionary, the definition of imitation, noun, is 1. An act or instance of imitating. 2. Something produced as a copy, counterfeit. 3. A literary work designed to reproduce the style of another author. 4. The repetition by one voice of a melody, phrase, or motive stated earlier in composition by a different voice. 5. The quality of an object in possessing some of the nature or attributes of a transcendent idea. 6. The assumption of behaviour observed in other individuals. Why do we imitate? On to the next important question. Why do humans imitate others? As briefly noted in Chapter 1, we think that there are two main motives behind imitation. The first motive for imitation is learning. Social learning refers to learning by observing others or in interaction with others. The general idea is that copying others allows people to avoid the costs of learning. For example, if you want to figure out how to use the new printer at work, you can go ahead and figure it out yourself, trial and error, or read the lengthy instruction manual, learning by instruction. Both are very time-consuming and require some effort from your side, the costs. However, if you simply watch your colleague using the printer and copy her step by step, it saves you time and energy. The motive of learning is also relevant in the zone of proximal development, ZPD, a theory postulated by psychologist Vygotsky. This zone is the difference between what someone can do by themselves and what someone can do under the guidance of a more capable person. The teenage son living next door, for example, cannot parallel park, but under the guidance of his driving instructor, he can do the job. Hence, parallel parking is in his ZPD. Vygotsky thought that people could learn new skills best if they were in this zone. In the ZPD, people can learn best from others by copying their successful strategies. The second motive is a social one. Everyone knows that imitation is the greatest form of flattery. Or at least that's what we like to tell ourselves when our co-worker Andy happens to buy the exact same pair of shoes you got for your birthday last week. Hence, the second motive why people like to imitate is in an effort to gain approval by others. And often this works too. Not with Andy, though. Studies have shown that mimicry, which is automatic imitation, such as copying someone's yawn, smile, or posture, increases liking. Hence, the one being copied will like the copycat more. And interestingly, there is a big mimicry-liking cycle. We mimic those we like more, which in turn leads them to like us more, and so on. In line with this, there are plenty of studies showing positive effects of mimicry. Specifically, mimickers are more trusted, they are more likely to be answered when they ask a question, and they are even considered to be sexier. But what about Andy? Why is imitation sometimes disliked? There are also plenty of examples when imitation is flat out annoying. For example, when a 10-year-old decides to repeat everything you say. One study suggests awareness might be the key factor here. When we are aware someone is copying us, we don't like them more. But when we do not notice the copycat behaviour, we will unconsciously pick up their mimicry and like them more. So only sneaky copycats rake in the benefits of imitation. An influential psychological theory called the optimal distinctiveness theory is in line with the motive to gain approval. According to this theory, humans have two competing needs. On the one hand, we have the need to be included, to be part of a social group and to belong somewhere. On the other hand, we have the need to be individuals, to be unique. The first need, inclusiveness, drives us to copy others in the group. The second need, uniqueness, drives us to differentiate us from others. As both drives are at play and balance each other out, people aim for a level of optimal distinctiveness. People strive to be like others, whilst maintaining a level of uniqueness. Thus, the motive to be included in a group, or to gain approval by fellow group members, can drive humans to imitation. But not only for humans is it important to blend in with the group. As we'll discuss in Box 2.2, animals also use imitation for this. Box 2.2. What can we learn from animals' imitation behaviour? Did you know that not only humans but most animals also imitate each other? For example, yawning is contagious not only to humans but to dogs as well. And infant chimpanzees, macaque monkeys and orangutans will mimic the smiles of their adult counterparts, just like infant humans. Animals too have several motives for imitation. A first motive is to blend in with the group to achieve safety. Predators are more likely to target individuals that stand out. Hence, it is worth the effort for animals to blend in with the group. A second motive is to convey a social message. Just like humans, monkeys seem to like being imitated. Finally, a third motive is learning. Like humans, animals can learn by watching others. This has been shown in many different animals, such as birds, dogs, and monkeys. In these studies, animals, for example, learn how to use a lever to obtain food after watching another animal using it. Who do we imitate? Now that we know why humans imitate others, let's discuss who we like to imitate. After all, we do not just copy everyone and anyone we see, do we? There must be a reason why the Rachel haircut was popular, but nobody seems particularly interested in copying my hairstyle. Box 2.3. A brief history of psychology. Behaviourism versus cognitivism. About 150 years ago, to be exact, in 1879, something incredible happened to the world of science. Experimental psychology was born. It was in that year that Wilhelm Wundt established in Leipzig, Germany, the first laboratory to systematically study human behaviour.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.